precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, help me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. Precious Lord, you're the one that I build my life on. You're my rock, you're my hope, you are my song. You pick me up and made me strong when my way, when it was wrong. Here's my hand, precious Lord, now lead me home. When my way grows drear, precious Lord, linger near. When my life is over, take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home. Take my hand, precious Lord, lead me home.
Thank you, Andrew. Good morning. Welcome to worship at St. Joseph First United Methodist Church. I'm Keith Foote, and I'm serving as worship greeter this morning, and we are glad you have joined us, whether in person or online. I have some opening verses. They're from 1 Peter chapter 1, beginning with verse 13. Therefore, prepare your minds for action. Be self-controlled. Set your hope fully on the grace to be given you when Jesus Christ is revealed. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance, but just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all that you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. Our opening hymn this morning is Take Time to Be Holy. It's number 395 in the hymnal. We'll sing verses 1-4, or you may simply follow along on the screens. Please stand as you wish and as you are able.
Thank you.
affirmation of faith this morning is number 884 in the hymnal. It is a statement of faith of the Korean Methodist Church. You may follow along on the screens also. We believe in the one God, creator and sustainer of all things, father of all nations, the source of all goodness and beauty, all truth and love. We believe in Jesus Christ, God manifest in the flesh, our teacher, example, and redeemer, the savior of the world. We believe in the Holy Spirit, God present with us for guidance, for comfort, and for strength. We believe in the forgiveness of sins, in the life of love and prayer, and in grace equal to every need. We believe in the Word of God, contained the Old and New Testaments, as a sufficient rule, both of faith and of practice. We believe in the Church, those who are united in the living Lord for the purpose of service. We believe in the reign of God as the divine will realized in human society and in the family of God, where we are all brothers and sisters. We believe in the final triumph of righteousness and in life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Please listen to the video announcements.
Good morning, church family, and happy Sunday to everybody. And I want to say especially thank you to all of those who have served on this Veterans Day Sunday. Just have a few announcements before we get started today. The first of which is, if you have not filled out one of our connection cards, whether it's your 7th, 8th, 216th time worshiping with us, please fill one of those out so we have as much updated contact information as possible. And if you or someone you know is in need of prayer, please fill out one of our prayer cards. Both can be found in the pew in front of you, and we'd love to be praying for you as a staff. Just want to let you know before we get started today that next Sunday is going to be In-Gathering Sunday. This is where we can bring non-perishable food item donations to the church, and they will be taken to local food pantries, used to restock our blessing box. So if you would like to donate to that, you can bring your donations in next Sunday.
Christmas is coming up so soon, which means decorating is coming up even sooner. I love Christmas here at the church. It is so beautiful. So if you want to help be a part of decorating the church, putting up the Christmas trees, all those beautiful things, you can sign up at the Opportunities Desk. It's Sunday, November 20th, right after the 11 o'clock service, and we can't wait to see everyone there. We'll have pizza, and it will get done a lot faster the more people we have. So we can't wait to see you guys there.
I want to remind all of our middle school and high school friends that Stoke Youth Group is meeting tonight from 7 till 8:30. We're going to be having a game night tonight. And for all of our pre-K through 5th grade friends, we're going to be having Spark Kids Club this Thursday from 6 to 7:30. Hope to see many of you there.
Don't forget, ladies, this week, November 15th at 7 p.m., right here at the church, we're going to be decorating cupcakes. We can't wait to have everyone there and eat all of the good cupcakes.
Everyone, that today after the 11 o'clock service at about 12:15, we're going to be having our second town hall meeting to discuss the things going on in our denomination and where we want our church to proceed in the future. So we hope that if you did not come to the first one, or if you thought of more questions that you would like to ask, please bring those to the town hall meeting today at 12:15.
Thanksgiving, one of the only times we get to seriously indulge on all of the good foods in the world, is coming up so soon. And Keith Foote is putting on a Thanksgiving meal on that day at 2 p.m. here at the church, and you can sign up at the Opportunities Desk.
We are wrapping up Operation Christmas Child. Boxes are due back to the church by this Friday, November 18th. If you've taken an Operation Christmas Child box, please get those in by then. We can't wait to get these sent out all over the world so kids can have a very special Christmas.
There are order forms for poinsettias at the Opportunities Desk. Don't forget to grab one of those so we can decorate with all of the amazing poinsettias for Christmas.
One of my favorite ministries that this church has done for years is the Angel Tree. So many kids in this world have parents that are unfortunately incarcerated, and this is a ministry where we decide to be an angel for those families. Every year we get so many children. I believe this year we have 26 kids that we're trying to provide Christmas gifts for. If you did not already see Mary Funk or Mark Lester in the lobby this morning, please talk to them if you would like to be one of these special angels that provides the gifts for these kids this year. You can find more information either in the newsletter or by talking to them in the lobby after the service. Now let's continue to worship the Lord together.
We're going to continue this morning by singing Let Us Plead for Faith Alone, which is number 385 in your hymnal, and we're going to remain seated for this. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for another Sunday. We thank you that we get to come here and we just get to worship you and learn about you. We get to draw closer to you. And we thank you that you're a God that we can never know enough about, that we always can know more and more about you, that you're a mystery and that you're so good and all-powerful and everlasting, and we can't even fathom fully who you are, God. We thank you for all the people that surround us in this congregation and outside of it, that we have support by other Christ followers, that we have love, encouragement, peace through those people, that you just continue to work through them and bless us. And we ask that you help us to be a blessing to others as well. We ask that you use us for your kingdom. We want to make heaven as big as it possibly can be. So we ask that you work through us, that you help us to show people your love, that you help us to show people your peace, your truth, your justice. Help us to rightfully represent you to other people. Don't let us represent you in a wrong way. Lord, we thank you that you are willing to work through us, even though we're broken people, even though we don't deserve it. You still use us, even though we mess up and we're not perfect. And we thank you that you just believe in us and that you want to work in us and you want to improve us, you want to know us. We thank you for that, and we ask you to help us have a desire for you as well. Help us to want to know you better. Help us to want to be in Scripture. Help us to want to worship you, to spend time with you, God, because sometimes we might not want to. So we ask that you put a desire for you in our hearts.
Lord, we pray for those who are in need of healing, whether it be inside our congregation or outside. So many people are in need of physical healing, and we ask that you just lay your hand on them. We thank you that you're the great physician, that even though doctors might not know what's going on inside of our bodies, that you know, and you know exactly how to fix it. So we ask for those who need your healing touch. We ask that you relieve pain from people, that you give them comfort, and that while you're healing them, you remind them that you are with them. And we ask for those who are in need of emotional, mental, or spiritual healing. Those are the most important things, spiritual healing. And we ask that you just continue to remind people that you love them, that you are the true God, and that you are with them. And we ask that you heal those people, whatever that may look like, whatever that may need to be. And that when you do that, that those people recognize that it's you. God, we thank you that healing looks different for everyone in every single circumstance, that you always continue to surprise us. We pray for those people that are in need, whether it be financially, whether it be a home, whether it be food, we ask that you just provide for those people. Thank you that you are a provider and you always give us exactly what we need, even if we think we might need it sooner. You give it to us when we need it. And we ask for those people, we ask that you provide for them and that they realize who is taking care of them. Especially as the weather is getting colder and colder, we pray for those who don't have homes, and we ask that you give them shelter, that you give them warmth, that you provide people around them that will take care of them. And we ask that you work through us. If we see people in need, help us to give. We pray for those who don't know you, whether it be inside this church, outside this church, people in our lives that we know, our own family members, people that we don't know. We pray that you just soften their hearts and somehow, some way, you show them who you are, and that somehow, some way, they believe you and that they know you. We pray for those people. Again, we want heaven to be so, so big. We want your kingdom to be big. And so we know that people don't know you, and we pray for those people that you somehow convert them, that you save them, that you give them a miraculous story and testimony so that they can go and spread it to others. And Lord, we thank you that you have already done that in our hearts too, that you have given us a story, a testimony, that you have saved us, that we get to know you. We have your word so we can know who you are and we can know exactly how you want us to live. Thank you for giving us that example. Thank you, Jesus, for being our living example, for being so willing to come down and live as a human, but also God, that you were a perfect person for us to follow. Help us to do that. Help us to follow exactly what you want us to follow, all of your teachings. Help us to remember all of your laws, how you lived. Thank you that you taught us so many different things when you were here on earth. And thank you that we get to pray to you. No matter where we are, what we're doing, we just get to talk to you, that you're available and that you listen. And thank you that you gave us the teaching of how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now at this moment, we're gonna receive someone into membership, so I'm gonna give it over to Dan.
Thank you, Savannah. Today is a good day because we get to bring another person into membership of our church. If you haven't had the chance to get to know Sue Cheshire, if you'd come on up at this time. Sue is the mother of Marilyn Herman, who's been a longtime member of our church as well. But Sue's been worshiping with us for quite a while, and she's going to be transferring her membership here. And we just kind of wanted to make it official and for you to all see her as well. So Sue, I'm going to ask you a few questions and then probably have you turn around and face the congregation after we get all done with this membership ceremony. And And I also have a certificate to give you at the end of this as well, okay? All right. Congregation, I'm going to ask you to turn in your hymnals to page 38. I'm actually going to start on page 34, so if you want to start there, but your response is going to be found on page 38. And because Sue's coming in as a transfer of membership, I'm just going to start at part 6 on page 34. According to the grace given to you, will you remain a faithful member of Christ's holy church and serve as Christ's representative in the world? If so, I will. And I'm going to skip up to page 38. And as a member of Christ's universal church, will you be loyal to the United Methodist Church and do all in your power to strengthen its ministries? If so, I will. And as a member of this congregation, Sue, will you faithfully participate in its ministries by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If so, I will. And now, members of the household of God, I commend Sue Cheshire to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase her faith, confirm her hope, and perfect her in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love as members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation of the United Methodist Church. We renew our covenant faithfully to participate in its ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. And Sue, if I can have you turn around and just face the congregation, let's give her a warm welcome into our church. I hope all of you will find her afterwards, give her a handshake, give her a hug, and congratulate her. And now I invite the choir up for the special music piece.
Thank you, choir. Good morning, everyone. It's so nice to be up here. I feel like I haven't been up here in ages, so I'm really glad to be up here. I'm glad to see you all. If you don't already know, my name's Savannah, and I'm the Director of Congregational Care here. And for the past few weeks, we've been kind of jumping around in the beginning of the book of Philippians, kind of learning about what Paul has to say there. And we've learned that this is a book of Christian instruction, basically, to the people of Philippi that Paul wrote. A lot of the times in this book, Paul's going over different topics about Christ following and what that should look like, and kind of encouragement, warning, all of that kind of stuff. And so today we're going to find ourselves in chapter 3 of Philippians, specifically verses 7 through 14. But before I even read that to you, before we dive into it, I think it's really important to know the context of these verses to fully understand what Paul is getting at. And so I'm going to tell you that the first 6 verses, Paul starts this chapter by kind of reminding the people of Philippi about things that he's already kind of talked about. He warns against evil, against people who are not true worshipers. And then he goes on to say what true worshipers are. He says, they worship in the spirit of God, in glory of Jesus Christ, putting no confidence in the flesh. And I want you to remember that. But he goes on to write something interesting right after that. And Paul writes that he might have confidence in the flesh. And it's because of all these things that make him righteous in terms of Jew or in terms of law. He writes that he was a circumcised Jew. He was a Pharisee. He's from the tribe of Benjamin. So he's like this true Israelite. And he's writing about all of these fleshly things that would allow him to boast about these righteous things. And these things that would make him privileged. And now here's where we find ourselves in verses 7 through 14. So hear the word. But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus had made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And so today we're talking about a heart set right. And I know this passage has a lot. It's very long. And so I want to break this up for us into some points. I love bullet points. And so for the first thing I want you to know about a heart set right is that a heart set right is set on the knowledge of Christ. So I don't know if you noticed, but verse 7, this little passage starts with the word but. He says, but I count all of these things that were gained to me as loss. So this is why I told you the context. He's talking about all of those things that I just told you about, all of these things that were gained to him, that gave him this good life, that gave him righteousness, that gave him a status of a true Israelite. He writes that, not that these things don't matter, but they're literally a loss for him. See, before, Paul was set on those fleshly things. He was a Pharisee. He was righteous by being a Pharisee, by following the law, by these fleshly things that made him a Jew. And he was a Pharisee that persecuted the church, thinking he was being righteous and following the law. His heart was set on what he thought the law was and what he thought the law wanted him to do. But now that he knows Christ, he counts all these things that were gained to him as a loss. And in verse 8, he even tops this. He says, more than just that loss, but everything is loss in the view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ. He's saying here that anything you could possibly think of is a loss compared to knowing Christ. Nothing could be more important than that. Just the value of knowing him is a gain over anything else. So Paul's heart was now set on knowledge of Christ over everything. And have you ever had something in your life, or multiple things, that at the time you thought were really good, or things that you thought made your life really good, like you loved those things, but then something else came along and you like completely forget about those things because they don't even matter anymore compared to this one thing? The only thing that I could think of in my life was like I had cake and then my mom gave me ice cream cake and I will never eat cake again. I will only eat ice cream cake. But that is what Paul is talking about here. Knowledge is gain. We have important things in our lives, important people, important jobs, but knowing Christ is the most important thing, right? Knowing Christ is what gives us salvation. It's what gives us eternal life. It's what gives us love, joy, truth, peace, everything good in our lives. Nothing can compare to knowing him. And I think that we know this, right? Like we're Christians, so that means we knew that and we made that choice to know him. But what we're talking about today, that knowledge of Christ is gain, is deeper than that even. Nothing else should compare to knowing Christ. Your heart should be completely set on knowing him. And when you're set on something, how much time and energy do you put into that one thing, right? Like it should be everything. You put all of your efforts into that one thing. If a student is set on one specific school, all of their studying, all of their tests, all of their practice interviews goes towards that specific school. They're consumed with getting into that school. If an athlete wants to be the best, all of their time, all of their energy goes into training, nothing else, right? And if we're set on knowing Christ, that's what should be taking up our attention, our time, our energy, getting to know him. Because you can eventually get into the school that you're set on. You can eventually become the best athlete, but you can never know Christ enough. You will never reach that point. Our lives are dedicated to the knowledge of Christ. So I want to ask you this morning, is your heart truly set on knowing Jesus? Do you count everything else in your life as a loss compared to him? Or are the things in your life that you look to as gain, as good for you, whether it be your job, your social life, movies, TV, games, hanging out with friends, is that what's taking up your time? Because you might think, no, Christ is more important, but what is taking up your time? Because that's what will show you what your heart is set on. So I want to encourage you to think about that today, and as you go throughout your week, and think about how you can focus on getting to know Christ. Read the Gospels. Read about how Jesus was. There's this awesome show that YNR has been watching called The Chosen. It's a free show. They have their own app. You can find it online. And they're just recreating the Gospels. And that was one of the most beneficial things to me, just being able to visualize like what Jesus' life would have looked like, what all of these disciples coming together would have looked like. I feel like I know Christ better because of it. But we need to have hearts that are set on the right thing as Christ followers, and that is a heart set on knowledge of him. So now my second point this morning is that a heart set on the right thing is set on righteousness through faith. If we're gonna go back to like the second part of verse 8 through 11, and so Paul continues on from this idea of everything being counted as loss compared to knowing Christ by writing this. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith. Okay, so now Paul is writing about suffering. And if you didn't know, Paul has a pretty rough life of suffering. Up until this point, he's left his really good life as a Pharisee. He was up there as a Pharisee. That would have given him a good life to be part of the Christian church, which is being heavily persecuted as its beginning. And so not only is Paul writing this specific letter that we're reading from a prison, but up until this point, he's been on multiple missionary journeys where he's had to flee for his own life. He's escaped scourging, which is the whipping that Jesus endured. He's escaping plots to end his life. So he's been through it. Paul has gone through a lot, literally for the sake of Christ, just so he can spread the word of Christ. And many people on the Roman and Jewish sides did not like that. But he writes all these things that he's endured, all these sufferings, plus all the suffering that he has lost, all this good life that he has lost by becoming a Christ follower. He counts them as rubbish. And I know it feels like we just talked about this, but what's really important is that the word that Paul uses here, the Greek word he uses for rubbish, means scraps thrown to the dogs. And we hear that in scripture sometimes. But also another word for this Greek word would have been feces. And obviously we think that's like a low thing. But you need to know, for this culture, that was like the lowest insult of all insults that you could say. That is like the dirtiest thing ever. And he says all of these things, he counts that, as garbage, as feces, as scraps thrown to the dogs. He doesn't even care about it. Because he has gained Christ, and he's gained righteousness through faith, not through himself, not through the law. Again, Paul used to be a Pharisee. His heart was set on righteousness by law. He was a stickler for rules. He persecuted the church. That's how he thought he was holy. That's how he thought he was righteous. That was everything he knew in his heart. And now he's saying, my heart is set on righteousness through faith in Christ. That's how I live right. Not something that comes from the world. This is how we live right, and we are found in God, by faith alone. When our hearts are set on righteousness through faith, instead of through the law, our hearts are set right. They're aligned right with God. In high school, around my junior year, is when I really started loving the church, like loving the environment of it. I really loved going to youth group, and that was kind of the year that I figured out I wanted to be in that environment forever. Like, I wanted to be in the church. That's where I love to be. And so I knew at that time, like, what it took to be a Christ follower, what I needed to do, and what church looked like. And since I knew that I was going to be following this path of being in the church eventually, I was getting more involved in the church, and I especially wanted to look the part. I especially wanted to look like a good person. I wanted people to know I was a good person, that I was in the church. And for me, I read the Bible. I wanted to read scripture, but I read scripture based on that. I read scripture based on wanting to look and be righteous. And so when I got to school to study theology, I quickly realized that I basically knew nothing about the Bible. Because when I was reading it, I wasn't reading it to know. I was reading it out of rules. And so now that I was in college and studying it to actually learn, I was learning so much about God. And that stirred up faith in me. And that faith in me is what led me to read scripture, because I wanted to. Because I wanted to know Christ. I wanted to spend time with him. And that is when Christ worked in me and changed me. When I had true faith. And a heart set on the right thing is set on righteousness through faith in Christ alone. Not in rules, not faith in ourselves, not in the world, but faith in God. And so what do you believe makes you a good person? What is it that makes you live right? Is it by following rules? By going through your checklist, by saying, okay, I read scripture, I listened to Christian music? Is it by looking a certain way to the outside world? Is it by going to church every Sunday, and that's it? If it is, our hearts are not aligned, and they're not set on the right thing. Our hearts are to be set on faith, and that is how we are righteous. When you have true faith in something, that means you're going to follow that thing. That means you're going to listen to what that thing says. So when you have faith in Christ, when your heart is set on righteousness through faith, you're going to listen to what Christ says, and you're going to live how he wants you to live. Faith and righteousness go hand in hand. When you have true faith, right living will follow. That's how that works. So I encourage you to think about that again this week. What is your heart truly set on? How can you set your heart on righteousness through faith instead of what you might be setting it on right now? Figure out the things that you have a hard time with, right? Faith is a 100% thing. It's not a less than 100% thing. So when you have faith in Christ, you have faith in everything he says, in everything he does. So find the things that make your heart hesitant. Is it Jesus' teachings on money? Is it his teachings on the poor, on equality, justice, truth? Ask him to make your heart ready for that truth. But our hearts are to be set on righteousness through faith, not in anything else. Now, last point. We're going through the point that a heart set right is a heart set on the goal. So we're going to be in a big chunk here, 10 through 14. So I'm going to read it again. That I may know him and the power of his resurrections, and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. So all of these verses connect. I know it feels like we're all over the place. We're starting in verse 10, but it's directly related to verse 9 because I started in the middle of a sentence. But he's writing that he counts everything as loss, everything as rubbish, so that he may gain knowledge of Christ, so that he may be found righteous in Christ through faith, and so that he may become like him in his death and resurrection. They all connect together. And so here, Paul's heart is set on the goal of heaven. That's the ultimate goal. These verses are the climax of this entire section. Like, most of us have heard these specific verses, like pressing on and straining forward to what lies ahead. So Paul here is writing about his heart being set on justification and sanctification, the ultimate goals of Christianity. Paul is set on sharing Christ's sufferings to become like him in his death and attaining the resurrection of the dead. So that means Paul is set on dying and rising with Christ, killing all sin in him, and then rising up to newness of life. That's what it's like to become like Christ in his death. And so Paul goes on to write that he hasn't already obtained this. He hasn't obtained this goal of heaven or this true goal of perfection, but he's pressing on towards it, the goal of heaven. Everything that he is doing is pressing on towards this goal of heaven. His heart is set on that goal of being justified in the eyes of the Lord and being sanctified or being made holy and perfect through the resurrection of the dead. The last day, when soul and body will be glorified, and all the saints will return to our real home, our goal of heaven. Everything points to this. So everything that we've been talking about today connects to this. This is what our hearts are set on. Paul's heart is set on the knowledge of Christ and righteousness through faith, because ultimately his heart is set on heaven. And as Christ followers, when our hearts are set right, we should be set on that goal. This is what we press on towards, leaving everything else behind. It doesn't matter what's behind us. Your heart may be set on knowing Christ. It may be set on faith. But is your heart set on the goal of heaven? Is everything you do and say pressing you forward and toward that goal? And if not, we have some work to do. And we always have work to do as we press on. Everything we do should put us closer to our goal. So when our hearts are set on something, it can't be set on anything else, right? If you're looking at one thing, you can't be looking at another thing. So today we've learned that there's only one true path, one true God, we knew that, one true goal, and our hearts are to be set towards it, nowhere else. And Paul here is an example to us of what that looks like. He's going through it. He's a huge example of a heart being set right, a heart being set on the knowledge of Christ, a heart being set on being righteous through faith alone, and a heart being set on the ultimate goal of heaven, to be with Christ forever. That's what his life pointed towards. That's what he strained forward to. And I think that is the biggest thing. Like, if I could be like Paul, that's amazing, right? If I can be like Jesus, wow. But if I could be like Paul, too, like, that is amazing. So let us take his example and his instruction and follow it in our own lives. This is scripture for a reason. Let us realign our hearts to be set on the right thing. Let's pray together. Lord, I thank you that you gave us scripture, that you gave us your word. And thank you that you worked through multiple people so that we don't have just one example. We have so many examples of what true God following looks like. We have so many instructions, we have so much encouragement, and we have so many warnings against what our lives shouldn't look like. And we just thank you that we have that truth. And today we ask that you help us be like Paul, that you help us set our hearts on the right thing. Help our hearts to be set on you, on knowing you, God. Help our hearts to be set on righteousness through faith, not by rules, not by anything else. And ultimately, help us to be set on the goal of heaven. Let everything we do in our lives push us forward towards our goal. And we thank you, and we pray all of this in your good and holy name. Amen. So as we continue, we're going to take up our offering now. And you can give in many different ways, financially, with your time, your talents, your energy. But as we continue to this song, I ask that you just wrestle with the Spirit and what he might be asking you to give today.
He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got all the power in his hands. He's got all the power in his hands. He's got all the power in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got you and me, brother, in his hands. He's got you and me, sister, in his hands. He's got the little baby in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. Stars and the moon right in his hands. He's got everybody in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands.
Lord, we thank you for this good Sunday. We thank you for this offering, and we ask that you just bless it and that you bless the hearts that are so giving. Help us to be generous and giving people, and we ask that this offering goes out exactly how you need it to go out, that it blesses so many people for the sake of your kingdom and for your glory. We love you, and we praise you, and we pray all of this in your good and holy name. Amen. We're going to be singing one last song together, My Hope is Built, number 368 in your hymnal. You can continue to stand and worship together.
Thank you.
Thanks for being here today. I'm really glad to see all of you guys. As you leave today, go in God's love, his grace, his peace, his healing, and go with a heart set right. Amen.